Coming up next, it's Sessions at West 54th, the music performance and interview series hosted by David Byrne. Tonight on Sessions, Tori Amos in a special one-hour presentation. Her bold musical statements and striking personal revelations have built one of the music world's most fervent, dedicated followings. See why in the special presentation of Tori Amos, including interviews by David Byrne. Up next on Sessions at West 54th.
Her songs of personal release and rebellion dig down pretty deep and have touched a huge audience. Although she's known for moving audiences with just herself and a piano, tonight she's joined by her brand new band and an expanded sound. Please welcome Tori Amos.
get a closer.
Do you think when you changed your name or took what in the old days was called a stage name, do you think that was a way of a kind of a way of kind of self-determination of saying, I'm going to be reborn as this new person, as this person?
Well, I think it's also correcting a serious mistake my mother made. I mean, I'm screaming from the womb, no, mother, Myra Ellen. That's like the worst. I hated that name. I mean, especially what boys can do as a 9-year-old with the word Myra on the East Coast. Oh, and their accents are horrible anyway. But Myra, Myra, it was just the worst. And everybody called me Ellen instead, but Elwin, you know, they dropped the L's. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, I got to tell you, I wanted to torch them too. And so I went through some really bad names, I must tell you, when I was going through my name change period. I almost became Sam E.J.
That's not so bad.
Oh, okay, thanks. Because I was watching, you know, Dallas or, no, Dynasty. Uh-huh. Dynasty.
I didn't know that was one of the characters.
Yeah, Sammy J. She was Heather Locklear's character. Sammy J. Anyway, I was getting into the whole Sammy J. thing, and thank God one of my friend's boyfriends came and just said, you're a Tory. I went, you know what? You're right.
This house is like a Russia, with eyes cool and gray. You got me moving in a circle. I dyed my hair a red today. I just want a little passion to hold me in the dark. seat while I take to the skies. Gonna take to the skies. Oh, my heart is like the ocean. It gets in the way. So close to touching freedom. My doctor said, are you just talking to the limit? And here I stand with this sword in my hand. You can see it one more time. What you don't like, I said, you can see it one more time. I go. Take to the sky. I take to the sky. Thank you.
I want to ask about RAIN.
Yeah.
The organization that you founded, right?
Yeah, with other people.
With some other people. What's the ongoing work? I mean, we know about benefit concerts and that kind of thing, but what's the ongoing work there?
Well, what RAIN really is it's a group of people that make sure that the phone line is running. It's a 1-800 number, mm-hmm. and the number is 1-800-656-HOPE. And RAIN picks up the bills that people, when they call from anywhere in America to a rape crisis center, the rape crisis centers can't afford the collect calls, you know. Mm-hmm. They're funded, and they have to take care of their, you know, bills. And there are about 600 rape crisis centers now that the phone line takes the caller to a counselor at one of these places. And RAIN is able to do that. And there are people, it works out of the D.C. Rape Crisis Center. That's where the hub of RAIN is. Part of the D.C. Rape Crisis Center is RAIN now.
Does knowing that an ear for the telephone, the other end of the telephone exists, does that help people call and say what's happened to them?
Well, I've been told we're about 225,000 calls now since 1994. That's a lot. Quarter of a million people. That's the good news and the bad news. But I've had people come up to me and say that they really were helped by RAIN, because it's not like just a friend who's sitting there going, yeah, yeah, you know, and kind of going like this mm-hmm. to watch the TV show, and they've mm-hmm. heard it enough and you feel like you're imposing. Those people at the other end of the phone line are really there to talk about that and to direct you. Some people need medical attention. Some people need legal advice. Some people need therapy. They really do. Some people are very ill, you know, very ill.
Did working with the decision to work with a band, was any of that influenced by people having done dance remixes of some of the songs?
Well, you know, a couple of things happened. Before all that happened, on Boys for Pele, Manu Katché played drums.
Yeah.
You know Manu. And he goes to me, listen, I used to record almost all the tracks, piano vocal or piano harpsichord, live mm-hmm. to tape. And then all the musicians would play on top of that rhythm, because I'd had kind of trouble with, not all drummers, but I'd had trouble kind of surrendering that and trying to, you know, finding a time where the songs didn't get pushed or...
Yeah, and it's a lot to surrender to make room for other people's parts.
And you gotta trust this drummer that he knows your internal rhythm and who this, the songs, I call them girls, who uh-huh. who this particular one is. And when she wants to pull back and when she wants to push, it's not about, you know, I've always said, you don't f*** to a metronome. Uh-huh. You can bleep that, you know. And the thing is, it's like, I was going, Manu, I don't know if I'm ready. And he said, listen, I'm not talking about me. And this is why I loved him so much. He said, but you need to find a drummer that you can trust, that for some reason you have that thing. Because uh-huh. he's one of the greatest drummers in the world. And he said, it's not about that. It's about some kind of secret language you have. And Eric Ross, who produced Under the Pink, who I lived with for a long time, called me up after I lost the baby and just said, I know the guy. And he said, this is Matt Chamberlain. You got to play with him. He had worked with Matt's band. And Matt came to the tropics and just, we hired a drum set and we jammed. Uh-huh. And it was like, I know you. He goes, I know you. And that was it. And I think that was a real huge turnaround.
Thank you.
Hey, check out the Sessions website. It's got information about this show, past shows, future shows, music, interviews, the whole kit and caboodle, the whole ball of wax. Here's the address, www.sessionsatwest54th.com. Do you think music is the most dangerous of the arts? People get more carried away by music. Listeners,
yes.
In that sense, they get inspired by music. They get inspired to do terrible things, and they get inspired to do wonderful things. More than they would, say, if you held a painting and showed it to them.
Yeah. Fair enough.
You can't imagine somebody running off to war after having looked at a painting, but after they've heard some music, you can imagine it.
Prokofiev. And
I'm ready. Open the door. Let me at them.
I think music can also be dangerous when certain people play it. It's like, oh no, I'm dying here. For me, I can't imagine my life without it. I really can't. I think I'd be, you know, 1 foot in as a sewage manager in some plant somewhere, because I don't know how I would have handled my aggression if I didn't have music. I put a lot into the piano. I sort stuff out. I think in another life, I was a mercenary or something. I could see myself. But I have a good side. You know, I have a nice side. But I could see myself. If I get pissed off, I can sit there and justify why I'm some, you know, whatever. I could have seen myself 1,000 years ago go do this. I don't see myself as this pious person. I am a bit volatile. And yet I don't really like confrontation, but I don't, you know, if it comes in front of me, it's like, I'm going to go for it.
So you think it's as dangerous for you as it is for the audience?
Oh. No, I think it's dangerous if I didn't have music.
Okay.
But so I put it in the music. Yeah, this is where I work stuff out as far as just on, if we're talking about, like, go back to Joseph Campbell, how they say that, you know, you probably have many myths running through your history or whatever. If we're not talking just about one lifetime, if we can even go there. And I'm not a New Age kind of, I think a lot in the New Age puts me off just because it's so, sometimes it's like, you know, just say the word love and it's all gonna be okay. And I don't agree with any of that. I feel like you gotta go to the shadow and you've gotta really see the stuff that you're hiding over here. And it's somewhere in here. Mm-hmm. So I feel like as far as the mythology goes, when I play, I pull on many different sides. And it's not always about the good guys or the good gals. It's characters that have maybe done stuff that we kind of cock our heads out and go, well, I don't know if this is a good character. And I'm going, that's not the point. They're in the myth too. And sometimes I try and channel them. You know, I try and bring those characters in. And there's this tension that you create. Mm-hmm. And you try and put yourself in everybody's position in the story. And that's what I try and do.
Here's a little contradiction. In high school, you were homecoming queen, voted, what is all this? Most likely to succeed, et cetera, et cetera. And yet, you still seem to feel like somewhat of an outsider. Is that right?
I kind of feel like, and one of my girlfriends, Cindy, came back, Cindy Loom, and I went to high school with her, came back to a show like a month ago in Houston. She goes, you know, I am pissed off with you. And I said, why? And she goes, you know, we were the cool chicks. We hung out together, and you're telling everybody we were nerds. And I said, well, you weren't a nerd, and I think it's more in junior high, I really felt like, hey, come on, everybody knew I played the piano, and I never got a date without playing a song for a guy. And I was pretty much
intrinsically linked with this thing, this instrument. So sometimes I felt like because of it, that was really my way in. And sometimes a bit manipulative, you know, write a song, pass a course, you know, little things like that. And I knew if I really wanted to go out with a guy, if things were going all wrong, maybe I could get him near a piano and maybe he would like me. Yeah.